Hello and welcome to P Guru's channel. I'm your host, Sri Iyer. Today, Mr. D.K. Hari of Bharath Gyan is joining us, and we're going to talk about rewriting the history of India, a step that should have happened after India became independent. Where this stands today, we'll get to know from him. Hari, welcome to P Guru's channel.
Namaste.
Hari, I was looking at the article that you wrote for mynation.com about the fact that history should have been looked at when India became independent to try and rectify some of the narrative that got, itihasas became mythological stories, and then there was this Aryan Dravidian theory, all sorts of things that were done, primarily, I think, by the British to try and keep India divided. Now, any real attempt that was made to rectify it during the last 70 years, do you think?
Unfortunately, there's not been an attempt to sort of rewrite the history. But before that, I'd like to make a statement before saying that. See, it's not only India, but many other nations have been colonized in different parts of the world. Most of them, after they got independence, they have taken effort to rewrite their history of their land, their country, from their perspective after they got independence. Whereas in the case of India, such an effort was not taken. But in other fields, other than history, we have taken efforts. For example, if you take the system of calendar that India has, in 1952, a calendar reform committee was formed under the eminent physicist Dr. Mehanand Saha to understand the calendrical system of India and write about it. So efforts have been taken in India in the first decade after independence to look at different aspects of India and sort of rewrite it or reform it or bring it forward to our needs then. Whereas in the case of history, it was not done. So that was a glaring omission. So what had happened was, when India was ruled by the British, the colonial historians did write the history of India. Quite a few of them. From their perspective, obviously they wrote it from their perspective. One of them is two people by name James Mill and Charles Grant. They wrote what is called History of India for the Indian Administrative Service Officers, or what is then called as, I think, ICS.
Yes, Indian Civil Services.
Were coming to India.
Indian Civil Services, right.
Indian Civil Service who were coming to India. So the British officers, for them, they wrote a history of India. And that became necessary in those days for them because Warren Hastings, the Governor General of India, was accused by the British company then, East India Company then, of having become very Indianized in his approach, because he had moved a lot of Indians, understood the depth of the Indian culture, and he was trying to look at it from an Indian perspective. So they didn't want that mistake to happen again. So they wanted to sort of whitewash or brainwash the officers before coming to India and look at it from only a British perspective, because that's what they needed to rule the land. So there's a college in England called the Helibury College. So every ICS officer who came to India had to pass through that Helibury College. So when he did that, the official book for them was by James Mill and Charles Grant, History of India. What do these two people say in that book? That they wrote this book, History of India, deliberately without visiting India, lest the rich culture of India influence them.
That's true. And in fact, I was just looking up Hastings' information. He was, in fact, impeached once he returned back to in England on the judicial assassination of a Maharaja. But the British did really want to make sure that Hastings is made an example of what a governor general ought not to be. Your body of work speaks for itself. And this has been done in such an unselfish manner, with the pure pursuit of truth, and to try and undo hundreds of years of consistent messaging that was against, and the truth was something else. And to be able to go and unearth all that is an achievement in itself. And I also would recommend viewers to look up Bharat Gyan channel on YouTube. There, Ram Setu was something for the ages. It's a fantastic piece of short film. And this is how you can keep your next generation children and their children to know what exactly what Bharat Varsha was, is, and should be, and will be. It's not going to change. This is based on Sanatana Dharma, which is eternal flow. This, we don't know when the flow started, and we definitely know it's not going to end anytime soon. So back to our topic.
Can I say something on this?
Yeah, please go ahead.
First of all, thank you for bringing up the subject, so kind of you. And it's actually 20 years of research that we have put in. Thanks for saying it's very selfless research and sort of time-consuming. It's a very patient research of doing this for 20 years. And also what we've been able to do is, see, it's also interrelated. It's not like, it's not, the Indian knowledge system is not compartmentalized. Every aspect of intertwined and interrelated. So we have to spread the whole thing to show the whole bouquet of knowledge. We have to spread. That is what we've been, in a way, attempted to do, and been fairly successful at it. So the span of time put in and the spread that we will bring out. And more importantly, if you see what we have done is just a conscious decision that to the people today don't spend time reading books.
Yes.
The reading thing has come down. So what we thought is we'll have to reach out to the people in the era of 2020 in the way they want it. So what we've done is, yes, we've written about, suppose I'll put it this way. Suppose somebody has say 4 or 5 hours time to know something of India. They have a book for it. It'll take them 4 or 5 hours to read a book. Suppose they know, I don't have 4 or 5 hours time with me. I have only about 20 minutes with me or 30 minutes with me. Then we have something called a mini book. It's available online to read easily, free read. Then suppose somebody says, no, I don't even have the 20, 30 minutes. I have only about 5, 7 minutes with me. Then we have an article, which is about 3, 4 pages. And suppose somebody says, look, I don't have the 5, 7 minutes. I have only 2 to 3 minutes. Then you have a short film to watch. Or suppose somebody says, I don't even have the 3 minutes with me. I have only about 30 seconds with me. Then we have banners. We have a few hundreds of banners on India, for each aspect of India. So we have a bouquet. So it depends upon the time that you have and the interest and what you can allocate. Because everybody is running 24/7. So in this, in the medium that you can offer, what you can offer is what we have brought forth in the palette for people to take from.
You know, you are being extremely modest. When I visited you last, I saw at least 15 books in the pipeline, and all of them were in various states of editing. So it actually was done, but you are going through to make sure the material was accurate and so on. So you are being very modest, sir, and I tip my hat to you and Hema, madam. And the thing that I really like is that you are able to stay in step with the technology. By the way, don't feel too bad. Today, the typical attention span is 8 seconds. So if you don't get them within the 8 seconds, I mean, people are moving on to something else. It's not anyone's fault. It is just that there is information overload and people tend to start making their choices, that they have their likes and dislikes, and they say they like to, on YouTube, they'll say, I would like to watch these 3 channels or 4 channels. And all these social media engines are very smart at figuring out what you like and what you don't like. So they keep feeding you with what you like. So what ends up happening is that you get a sizable amount of information. The important thing is how much wide a net you're able to cast, so that the more people start getting intrigued by the information you provide. And I think you summarized it excellently. You have stories for all time spans. And I think that's an excellent thing. By the way, this is an interesting trend that I'm seeing. If I don't know if you watch Netflix or Amazon, many people in the West and even in India, it is starting now, are beginning to watch. And there what happens is you end up doing binge watching. That is, you start at 8 a.m. or 10 a.m. in the morning. You spend the entire day till like 8 p.m. watching a one story, because they usually have like 10 episodes per season. Then the season goes to the next one and the next one and so on and so forth. Game of Thrones was one. There are many other stories which are fascinating. So even though we say that there is a short attention span, we also seem to see people who don't mind sitting and watching these things for an entire day. So here is, that is an interesting conundrum that we are going to try and solve. So I expect that you will have a series like that, which perhaps Netflix or Apple, Disney, a lot of new players are coming in. Somebody might pick it up, as long as the attention, the storyline is strong and you keep the people's interest alive. I mean, Ram Setu is an excellent example.
We are working towards it, sir.
Yeah, Ram Setu is one excellent example. I don't know how long it is, but I have watched it from beginning to end, because sometimes I'm actually trying to note down the dates that you have mentioned, so that if I'm going into some debate or something, I don't want to get these things wrong. And I still get them wrong. But you get the point, right? I mean, these are important things. And the research that has gone in to making that movie is very apparent when you see the movie.
Thank you. It was totally Hema's effort, actually. And one more thing is, we have made a simple timeline chart. It's available in our channel, in our website, as well as our blog, of right from the time of Rama all the way up to Adi Shankara to Alexander. There's a simple timeline chart available for each of the dates we're given, and proofs thereon. So when they normally say ancient Indian history does not have a timeline, here what we have done, we feel proud to have made that contribution to the field of ancient Indian history, right from the date of Rama being 10th January 5114 BCE to that of Krishna for 32272. We also given specific timeline for when the Veda were compiled.
Oh, you mean like Rig Veda and so on?
Yeah. We say this is a Vedic era, but nobody is till date been able to give exactly on which date Rishi Krishna Dwaipayana sat down with a team of Vedic Rishis to compile the Veda together. So we are given a 12-year period, and that is called Shrauta Satra, was the name of the conference that they held on the banks of the Saraswati Nadi. So we can the latitude and longitude where it was held and the dates. It was from 3141 BCE to 3129 BCE. It was a 12-year period.
I see. So right around Mahabharata, maybe a little bit after.
Before.
Okay. Before Mahabharata. So what is your timeline for Mahabharata?
The Kurukshetra war started on 22nd November 3067 BCE.
Okay, 3067. Okay.
3067 BCE. 22nd November. I can't forget the date because it's my wife's birthday.
Your wife's lucky. Many of us forget it.
So that's the date when we got the Bhagavad Gita. It was not only the start of the war date, it's the date that that the civilization, the world got the words directly from the divine himself.
Great. Bhagavad Gita. Great stuff, great sharing. And we have viewers, a series of talks lined up with Dr. D.K. Hari and Dr. Hema Hari, and we'll be bringing them out in a sequential fashion. And we are working on the things. This is above and beyond what you can find in Bharat Gyan page. By the way, it's an excellent channel on YouTube. I encourage everyone to go watch it. There is no point in trying to redo the same thing again, P. Gurus. What we are going to do in P. Gurus is bring it in contemporary context, because there are so many excursions going on and new things always keep coming up. So for your research, what do you rely on? I mean, this stuff cannot be done without doing a humongous amount of research. What are your research methods? Do you need any help from volunteers who might be able to help you just because they happen to be living in a certain place that you want research done?
Research colleagues are certainly welcome. Volunteers welcome. They can live in any part of this Bhuloka. They don't have to live geographically near us, because today the world is one digital village.
Yes,
so it's eminently possible, and we do need hands to take it forward. More the hands to media, because it's all working on the knowledge of the civilization at best. And as you ask that question, see, earlier it was, when you look at history, it was only some history books and archaeology. These are the two primary matters that people were depending on. But today, in the last few decades, it's opened up newer windows. The one window it opened up a couple of decades back was the field of archaeoastronomy. It opened up. Because, and that was one of the early people who used the term, or even coined some components of the term archaeoastronomy. Because archaeo comes from the word archaeology or archaic, old. So in archaeology, you dig into the ground with a pickaxe and a shovel and a crowbar, all that, you dig into the soil. Whereas in archaeoastronomy, you dig into the sky of the past. That's how the term archaeoastronomy itself was coined. And how do you dig into it? What you do is, you have dates mentioned in our traditional texts, be it the Ramayana. I mean, you have star positions mentioned, not the dates, you have star positions mentioned.
Right.
The Ramayana or Mahabharata or the Purana or different other texts. It could be a Tamil text, or it could be an Assamese text, or it could be a Telugu text, or any language. You got for different events, for different rishis, for different kings. You have their the day they were born, or their Patabhishekam, or different aspects. Similarly for Buddha's Nirvana, Parinirvana, different things you have date. There are star positions mentioned. There's an eclipse or not. Those things are mentioned. That sort of mention is very unique to Indian chronology, or Indian way of recording. So these are timeless. So using these earlier, what had happened was, a couple of hundred years back, this had to be done manually. And there were many people who were doing it manually. One of them, well known, is a person named Swami Kannu Pillai. He used to do it. So his ephemeris are quite famous. It runs in pages and pages of Swami Kannu Pillai's ephemeris are there. That's been done. But now the advantage is, with the coming of software, this can be done more easily. Of course, it's a laborious process, but it is comparatively, it can be done easier, wherein you can try to search for those planetary positions or those eclipses or all that in the software to arrive at what probable dates it could be, and then see whether they all sequentially fit in through the sequence as mentioned in the story and interrelated, what we call interdisciplinary approach now. So that is thrown up newer concepts, so that we don't have to depend only upon archaeology. We can now use literature also more effectively.
Yeah, and see, that's what makes the Ram Setu video compelling viewing, because you are not satisfied. You are not satisfied just by providing the planetarium software reading. You also went back and looked at the sea levels to try and see if there is a different way to come up with the date. See, that's what makes something believable, acceptable to the rigorous academic standards that research is held up to.
Absolutely. And that interdisciplinary approach is a new thing that's come up, and that's what's going to hold the fort and bring out all these things. And the other big advantage that we have in this century over the last century in dating of Indian timeline is a big advantage is, see, the colonial historians dumped all our thought as mythology. The word mythology comes from the word myth.
Myth, right.
Myth, again, the English word myth comes from the Greek word mythos, meaning untrue. Or there could be a small bit of truth from which a large story has been built on. Probably there's a small figment of data from which it's built on. Incidentally, this word mythos in turn comes from the Sanskrit word mithya, meaning untrue. So the Sanskrit word and the ancient Greek word mythos and Indian word Sanskrit are sort of so similar. So from that it came mythology. Why did the colonial historians in a single draw of a pen called everything in India mythology? That we have to understand from their perspective. They had a genuine problem in their mind then. That is, in 1650s, there was a bishop by name Reverend James Usher in Ireland. He had fixed the date as a declaration wherein he had said that God created earth at 9 a.m. on 23rd October 4004 BC. And anybody who says anything contrary to this is an heretic. So it sort of pretty much fixed everything, because when you say you're a heretic, means you can be burnt on stakes.
Yes, yes. And
so that's what he said. So you can't oppose this thing.
Yeah.
It was cast in stone. And for a couple of hundred years after that, from 1600 onward, that held sway that the earth was created at 9 a.m. Let's be more precise. At 9 a.m. on 23rd October 4004 BC. Why 23rd October? Why not 22nd October? That's you can't ask him, because if you ask it, you're a heretic. It's 9 a.m. You can't ask why not 8 a.m. It's only 9 a.m. So that was the iron cast it was in. So what these colonial historians actually faced the problem was, how can you have history in India of Rama or Krishna being born in India when the earth itself was not created? So it's a major problem for them. So they had to compress it. So all that fell, and mind you, if the earth was created at 9 a.m. on 23rd October 4004 BC, then you had 1,000 years of rain. Then the deluge the water has to subside.
Noah's Ark. After
that, yeah. Only you can get Adam and Eve and the apple, all those things. Then the apple tree has to grow. Then Adam and Eve have to come about. So all those things. So basically, they had a glass ceiling much after 4,000 for a couple of thousand years for the rain and the deluge to subside. Only then man can come, only then apple tree can come, all that they had a problem. So they had to fit. And when they came to India, they found the history of India going back more than a few millennia beyond when the water hadn't subsided post the earth being created and the deluge and all those things. So what did they do? They compressed everything in India. So anything before that is mythology. And the first event in India they thought fit to date was the date of Buddha. And who dated this date of Buddha? A person by name E. J. Rapson. He, in his book Ancient India, he dates the book. And he very clearly states when he dates the book that it's a provisional date. He gives some date of 450 or 560 BC for the date and says it's a provisional date. That's all. So, but what happened is this provisional date of E.J. Rapson became the benchmark for all other dates in India and relating to India. So, without even ever checking the veracity of this provisional, so-called provisional date, it became it was ironed into the Indian thought that was the original date. While Max Muller himself had given a date of 1020 BC for Buddha's time, and the Tibetan dates go back by 1200 BC, and Bishop Degandate of Burma, he gives a date of 1800 BC. So the multiple dates
for when Buddha came to earth.
Yes, Buddha was born on earth. So that's there. Whereas many Indian historians also parallelly worked on it, and they have come up with the correct date for Buddha as being 1800 BCE. So Buddha was actually compressed by 1400 years to 400 BC. So when you remove the glass ceiling of this 4004 BC for God having created earth, so since then that's been totally removed now. So the glass ceiling is removed, you can, and the sky is open to look afresh and position the correct dates of Indian timeline in the correct place. When you do that, automatically your Rama becomes historical, Krishna becomes historical, because they go back by a couple of thousand years. So you now know the earth did exist before 4004 BC.
That's true.
So you can really know the people on this earth. So now archaeology has proved it, geology has proved it, astronomy has proved it. So multiple fields have taken out this thought of James Usher's declaration of 4004 BC. So that was the holding point for us. Now that cap has been removed, that artificial glass ceiling cap has been removed. But we haven't, while it's been removed the world over in all sciences, in Indian history, unfortunately, that still holds. That old cap still holds. Because only if you remove that cap from your mind, can you open up the window for fresh air and look at the Indian thought beyond these dates and to fit them the correct dates, which is what we have done in our timeline chart.
So maybe in one of our upcoming chats, we can talk about, you know, some of these things, how datelining. We did a little bit of introductory thing with Hema once about the concept of dating and why it is important. Perhaps we should get into it in a little bit more depth and try to figure out how, I mean, carbon dating is one way that, you know, today archaeologists use to try and see when that particular thing was built. If it is a piece of pottery, you can look at that and say, okay, this is when it was built. But there should be more than that, because everything has a certain accuracy. And after some point, their accuracy also starts coming into question. For example, I'll give you one instance. In Dholavira, they found a statue of somebody doing Padmasana, and that was dated to 5000 BCE or somewhere in that part.
Yes, so, yes.
And then there is anecdotal evidence that a city 3 to 4 times the size of what is there on Dwarka today lies under the water because of the fact that, you know, the sea levels have risen. And we don't even know what the dates are, but there are some interesting stories that are there on YouTube. We can talk about that in a next episode, because there is so much fascinating stuff that needs to be just observed. Forget about, you know, trying to document it in book form, bringing it out. But there is so much that needs to be still looked at. So, Hari, if you would like to say anything in conclusion, I think I'm done with all my questions for this hangout.
So, the key point is, so that, when you look at history of India, it's a very important point. As I have said many times, history is too serious a subject to be left to historians. Because the subject of history is actually a mind bender. See, if you study physics or chemistry or biology, it's a subject you study for that vertical alone. And you do professionally well in that subject, and which gets you an employment and a bank balance. Whereas the subject history decides how you think of your civilization. So that's a key factor. So it fashions your mind, it fashions your society. And we have had so much of myth built on this, that we Hema and I thought it fit to bring out a book called Breaking the Myths About Our Identity. It's a book that's available where we clearly say that there are so many myths shackling our free thought process that we need to be unchained to look at our antiquity, our heritage from a fresh perspective, removing those cobwebs in our mind, removing the moss that's making a slip. Or when you drive a car, you can't drive with the handbrake on. So like that, you need to sort of open up and see. And that new thought, fresh thought, is what is essential. And the youth are empowered to do it. It's after all their generation, it's their heritage, and we are at best facilitators. And opening this window and showing it to them to take it forward. So the history of this land is a history of a civilization, not just a nation of 70 years independence. It's a history of a civilization that goes back to 7,000, 8,000 years and beyond, and a continuous history. That's the beauty of it. And when you look at, see, there's a field called historiography. The historiography of Europe is different from the historiography of the Indian civilization. See, Europe had only two main spans of history, each of 700 years each. From 350 BCE to 350 CE, they had history in Europe. Right? Then it was a dark ages for about 1,000 years. And again, from 1350 CE, again, they have history, real history, documented history. So they have only 700 years, two widths of 700 years of history. So what is the focus was of the kings, the names, their sons, the wars they fought, and all that. So the focus was on a timeline and the wars and the names of the kings. Whereas in India, the history is 7,000 years of continuous, unbroken history. So what does this do? So the historiography itself has to be different, where the names of kings are actually immaterial. What wars they fought and won are actually immaterial. The dates are immaterial. Because it's too long a span to remember all the kings' names and all the wars they fought and all their sons and all the how many sons they had. It's actually not going to be worth it. What matters then is the values. that our heritage teaches us. So it's a value-based history. So historiography focuses on values. Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha. Or the Purusharthas. So that is, so the very clearly, the historiography in the Indian thought, be it in the Purana or Itihasa or in the ballads or the folklore or whatever you would like to, the street plays or whatever you like to call, or that was held in each nukkad through the ages in every village, theater, everything had a few kings' name, but the focus always values. Values how you have to lead your life in dharma, in sync with nature, in sync with society. So that was the historiography of the land. Actually, we had 22 varieties of recording history. It's mentioned in our book, Breaking the Myths, where you were shown there are 22 varieties. So not just one variety. So that's the range we had. So to say that India did not have history is actually, again, untrue. And the historiography itself was, again, different. We didn't need the historiography of the of a colonial West, which had a short span of 700-year history. We had a 7,000-year history. So the methodology is different and the need is different.
Thank you very much, Hari, for sharing your thoughts on this topic. And we will be back with more such interesting conversations. Viewers, please do not forget to click on the subscribe button. The subscribe runs all the way through this video on the bottom right corner. You can subscribe to the channel anytime. And whenever new videos come online, you'll be notified. Also, if you could please take a moment out to donate to our cause, we would really, really appreciate it. The donate link is paypal.me for me /pgurus. Thank you very much. And thank you, Hari, again for joining us. Thank you.